Live from the Wildlife Science Center in Forest Lake, Minnesota, Bell Live presents The World of Wolves. Our electronic field trip will help you study a pack of socialized wolves in captivity. Experience the powerfully effective and intriguing body language of wolves as these creatures compete to be leader of the pack. Come along as we take you inside the pen to study the wolves, meet young pups born in captivity, and see how the fight to be dominant begins as a baby. Watch as we do scientific research on these fascinating animals. It's The World of Wolves, live. And here's your host, Peggy Knapp.
Hello and welcome to the Bell Live's World of Wolves broadcast from the Wildlife Science Center in Forest Lake, Minnesota. Let me tell you a little bit about the center. The Wildlife Center began about 14 years ago, and it's run by a group of very dedicated biologists. And they're working to help wolves make a comeback in many parts of the world. Their studies in animal biology are critical to the survival of wolves. And as you look around the compound, you can see a lot of the pens, and we'll be going all around the compound to give you a look all around this place and see the wolves that are here. But first, I want to introduce you to the executive director of the Wildlife Science Center. She's a wildlife biologist, Peggy Callahan. Another Peggy. Hi, welcome, Peggy.
Thank you. Nice to have you here.
Great. We have so much stuff to cover today. It's going to be a very exciting day, but the first thing we want to talk to you about is how you are able to get this broadcast from Minnesota into your classrooms. We're going to show you a shot of our satellite truck. And then we're going to go inside the broadcast truck and talk to Brian Tuttle, who's our project manager. And he's going to explain a little bit about how you're able to get this broadcast. Hello, Brian. Are you in there?
Hi, Peggy. It's good to be here today. It's a pretty exciting show, too. Now, here at the Wolf Compound, here at the Wildlife Science Center, what we have are four cameras that will take pictures of the wolves and various wolf shots and Peggy today. And then those shots will be brought into the control room. Now, the control room is where the director, the producer, all the audio, all the video people are. And they will mix all the pictures together and then send them over to the satellite truck. And then the satellite truck then takes that, puts it on the satellite. The satellite then brings the picture down to your room or your classroom or your auditorium, wherever you're viewing the show. And hopefully we're going to have a very, very nice show for you today with a lot of nice pictures and information. So there you go.
Dissolved one.
Thank you, Brian. All right, we have one more bit of business to take care of before we start talking about your wolves. And that is we have a bunch of kids here who are going to help us with our broadcast today. Lucky kids. I'm going to have them tell you who they are, and they got some hellos for you.
Hi, I'm Robert Furler from Cadet High School, and I want to say a hello to Montreal, Canada.
I'm Michael Hampton. I go to Greenville Park School, and I want to say a big hello to Las Vegas, Nevada.
Hello, Las Vegas.
I'm Jason Tyson. I'm from Watertown Middle School, and I want to say hi to Tulsa, Oklahoma.
I'm Joel Hansen, and I go to Menominee High School, and I'd like to say hello to Denver, Colorado.
Hello, everybody out there. We're so glad you could join us. All right, let's talk about wolves. First of all, let's start with why are the wolves here at the Science Center?
The wolves that are at the center are here to stay. These are not animals that will be reintroduced into the wild anywhere. These guys are the test animals, the place where we learn anything that's ever going to be done on a wild wolf.
So you really practice all your procedures here at the Science Center.
It's research.
Okay, what about your relationship with wolves? You've been involved with them for a long time.
Yes, it's a little bit personal, but it goes back many, many years. When I was 8 years old, I first wrote to a wildlife biologist, a wolf biologist, and he wrote back, the fool. I kept that letter, and it guided me through my decisions as I entered a career. And somewhere along the way, I made a connection between my love for wolves and science. And here I am.
And you can have a job doing what you love.
That's right.
So that's very important. If you're interested in that, stay with it. Now, another thing is you name all your wolves. Why do you do that?
I do name the animals. Well, first of all scientists don't wear white lab coats and work with rats. These animals are actually individuals. And since they live in a pack and their personalities are so important to their existence, it's important for us to be able to distinguish between them. So I name them based on their personalities.
Now, I want to learn more about that. This pack that we see over to our right is what's called a social specialized pack. What does that mean?
Well, that means that they've been bottle-fed from infancy by us, so that natural fear of humans that's in every wolf is slightly overcome, and they think of us as something akin to a pack member, even though they don't think we're wolves.
They don't think you're wolves,
no.
But you have to play by their pack rules.
That's right.
What are some of the pack rules?
Well, the pack rules are that leadership is absolutely all important. There are two leaders that run that pack, and everybody else that's lower ranking needs to obey those rules and those laws, and everybody that's below the leaders always looking for a chance to move up.
So the social structure, how they're organized, isn't always that way.
No, absolutely not. If there's a chance to move up in rank, who wouldn't?
And why would they want to move up?
Well, because in the wild, where life is difficult, only the leaders have puppies, and only the leaders eat their fill. So if there's not much food, Peggy, guess who goes without?
Yeah, the
low ranking.
Yeah, low man on the totem pole.
That's right.
Now, I always thought when I was growing up of the big bad wolf, and it's unpredictable, and it's wild, and sly, and wily. Is that true, or can you really sort of predict their behavior?
Yep, that big bad wolf thing doesn't really have much to do with truth. And predictable, they are predictable if we take the time to study everything that we can about wolves.
Like, what can you predict?
Well, I can predict that even if an animal looks very content to be a low-ranking animal today, if they have a chance to move up in rank, they're gonna. And even if it means over me.
So that's that opportunistic. They're always trying, they're always looking for a way to move up in the social order.
That's right.
Now, this is something that you in the classrooms can do, is you keep observations, like you were saying. You observe all of their behavior and you keep track of that. So as we go through the broadcast today, that's something that you might want to do on your observation sheets, is just to record what you see the wolves doing. And we've done that with some videotape.
Yes.
And we talk about how you can read wolves. They really talk with their bodies, don't they?
They do. They use body language, and so do we. But their body language is critical to reinforcing in one another who the leader is and who isn't.
All right,
we can see that.
Let's take a look at the videotape that we have and tell us what kind of behavior we can read.
Okay.
Here.
As you can see from this body language, there are all kinds of things to watch, but let's focus on the tail first. That animal has a very relaxed tail, a tail that's higher or lower in between their legs would indicate that there's something social going on, but both of these tails, this one too, is just a fairly relaxed animal. If something were to cause problems, if there was a higher ranking animal, the tail would be higher, a low ranking animal would be tucked between their legs, and if two were close together, like in this case, we can see which one is higher rank based on who has the higher tail. That wolf on the left has a high tail, the wolf on the right a low curled tail. In a situation where they're encountering one another.
So tail's important.
That's right. In this case, we had two wolves with their tails very high, indicating that both of them are vying for the same place. They're trying to be the leader, both of them.
That's a challenge, then.
That's right. That's a challenge.
Oh, this is obvious.
This guy is using the other half of his body, the business end. This is in a display of aggression. Draven is popping his teeth and baring his teeth. That jaw snapping or clapping is not something that's unique to wolves. There are other animals also that will express displeasure. Dolphins and bears will do the same thing. But I think everybody can see that this is not a friendly gesture that I'm getting.
Oh, yeah.
This guy's raising his leg to urinate. Well, don't all boy dogs do that?
Well, I would think so.
No. Actually, in a wolf pack, this is a boy wolf. Also, the low-ranking animal doesn't get to raise his leg because he's not the boss.
Only the boss gets to raise his leg.
That's
and only
right.
The boss gets to breed?
That's right. It's another way for us to use our tools to watch animals and learn about who's the leader.
The boss gets a lot.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we've got some questions. The kids out there have some questions for you. So I'm going to take the first one from Clayton, and he's in Indiana. So Clayton, are you out there? Ask your question. Try it again, Clayton. We can't quite hear you out here. Okay, I'm going to take a question from our... Oh, I got a question right here.
How fast can they run?
How fast can wolves run? That's
a
good question.
Yes, it is. Wolves don't spend a whole lot of time trying to run fast because they have to save their energy, but if they need to, they can get around 35 miles an hour. For a little while.
35
that's
for
right.
a little. What's their average?
That's 10 to 15 miles an hour. That's their regular comfortable jog. I don't do it that fast.
I wouldn't either. Okay, we have Chris from Waconia. Chris, are you on the line there? Go ahead and ask your question.
Has a wolf ever been attacked by a weasel?
Has a wolf ever been attacked by a weasel?
You know,
one of those fighting weasels, no
that's
doubt.
That's right. Well, before I went into science, I would have said no, but I never say never. Maybe.
Maybe.
It's a gutsy weasel.
Yeah. That's a really gutsy weasel. All right, how about one more from back here? Anybody? You already had a question.
Do wolves bark like dogs?
Do wolves bark like dogs? That's
yes,
a very good
do.
Question.
Yes, they do, and it is a good question. Many of the sounds they make are similar to dogs, including the bark. The bark is something that indicates, hey, there's somebody in my territory that I don't want there. So in that way, a wolf certainly will, but they're not likely to bark at people because they're so afraid of people. They don't take the risk.
Ah, so it's usually not like dogs have a friendly bark.
Yes, unless you're trespassing, then they don't.
Oh, that's true. Okay, do we have time for one more question? No, we don't have time. We got to go on. All right, let's talk about more about that aggressive behavior. Now, there's different levels of that, isn't there?
That's right.
Okay, so there's some that's just normal that they do every day.
Yes.
All right, well, we have a piece of videotape about that kind of behavior. So why don't we roll that and you tell us what
okay.
we're seeing.
Their social structure is so important that a high-ranking animal isn't necessarily just going to show posture through tail or through wrinkling lips, but sometimes they will actually reinforce their position through physical roughness. It looks pretty nasty, and here we're going to see a clip of that. It's a wolf actually exerting aggressive dominance on another wolf. Now, this isn't a fight we're seeing, Peggy. This is just a normal display of aggressive dominance and very active submission. That
and what
wolf
are
looks
they
very
saying?
Submissive. They're saying, I'm the boss, and there are resulting
oh,
injuries.
Look, that's a deep wound.
That's right. It's a scratch, but it's not life-threatening. It's they take their role very seriously. Rank is very important.
But you say that's not a fight?
It's not a fight. Not a fight.
Okay, well, we have a picture of that fight, and this is a home video that you shot, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
And it's hard to watch.
It's very hard to
it's
watch.
It's a real hard fight, and it gets bloody, doesn't
yep.
it?
Yep, it does.
All right. Well, why don't we take a look at that fight, and you go ahead and tell us what's happened.
Okay. What we have in this situation is one low-ranking female that's challenging the leadership of that high-ranking female. The high-ranking female is the lighter colored animal. And you can see that this is a very serious challenge. And they're fighting with all of their fervor. Although there are a bunch of wolves around there, there's only one that joins in the fight additionally, and that is that high-ranking male, the alpha male, the mate of the alpha female, and he does so to help her.
But the others don't get in.
Nope, he takes some cheap shots. The other thing to note is that even though they are fighting very, very powerfully, one thing both of them are doing is communicating through other means, their body language, their tail postures, and their hair is still raised, indicating, oh. Hey, I haven't given up yet.
Why didn't you stop this fight?
We weren't allowed to stop the fight, much the same way that other wolves were not allowed to get involved. We are pack members, and we were not allowed to get involved. So we were stopped. This is
the
very, very important.
The wolves
stopped you? Yes, this is a
so
very important thing
So this is something that really has to happen for their structure.
Yes, it happens in captivity and in the wild. Just because we have them in a place like this doesn't mean that they're domestic or tame. They are still wolves. And the only thing that's different here is that I can console everybody. Both of these animals survived this fight, and there's a whole lot more gore than really, really was there. But this was very important.
So this is really why they don't make pets.
This is a big part of why they don't make big good pets, because if you were a pack member, you might be subject to the same challenge.
Oh.
And I can't withstand that. I don't know about you.
No. Now, who won this fight?
Raisa did maintain her status, and she was the boss, and Rebecca had to start a new pack of her own.
That's a costly fight.
Yes, indeed.
All right, well, it brought up some questions, and we're getting some questions in right now. The first one we're going to take is Vincent from Virginia. Vincent, are you out there?
Hi.
Hi, Vincent.
Hi.
Go ahead and
Hello.
Ask her.
Go ahead. My question is, if alpha male is sick, does he stay alpha until death, or do they have a new alpha while he is sick?
Ah, oh. So if an alpha male gets sick, will he keep being the alpha male, or will something else happen?
That's a good question. It depends on how sick he is, because he is going to pretend that he's not sick. It's very important for him to look well, so if he's not super, super sick, he can fake it. And that's why taking care of wolves in a situation like this is tricky, because they'll pretend they're not sick right up until the time they're very ill.
And what'll happen if the other wolves catch on that he's
sick?
If
they catch on, what you saw in the video just may happen, that a high-ranking wolf will be thrown out of power.
So they'll have a fight.
That's right.
They are opportunistic.
Yep.
All right.
Yep.
We got another question coming in from Blake. He's at the Bell Museum. Blake, go ahead with your question.
Hi.
Hi.
I wondered how often the wolf breed.
How often does
it breed? Well, and I'm going to remind everybody that the only animals that do breed in a pack are the alpha male and the alpha female, but that only happens once a year. not more frequently like in our pet dogs. Dogs can breed much more frequently than that. And dogs only breed, or wolves only breed once a year.
So it's by season.
That's right.
Okay. We had another question that came in by fax, and it's Sarah from Waconia. She wants to know how many wolves are killed each year by hunters.
Oh, well, I'm going to answer that. There is a legal hunting season in Alaska, but in Minnesota we have another problem. It's called poaching. And poaching is illegal taking. It's not hunting. And we have probably about 350 to 500 wolves that are taken illegally every year. And
wow.
Those are numbers from the federal government.
That's a lot.
That's a lot of animals, and it's very frustrating.
So it's a big problem.
Big problem.
Yeah. All right, you're going to take me into this wolf pack.
That's right, after that fight?
Yeah. Yeah, let's go right on in there. Can you get their attention before we go in?
Yes.
Just to let them know
yep.
we're coming?
Okay, you guys.
Oh, they really pay attention.
They
now,
do.
Is there anything I should know before we go in there?
I suppose I should tell you.
Yeah,
yes.
Give me something.
Because
the big red wolf is all over
that's
my
right,
head right
that's
now.
Right. You've got to leave Little Red Riding Hood out of the pen. These guys are not mind readers, Peggy. They can't read your mind, but they can read your body language. You've got to pretend you're not afraid, even if you're very afraid. You have to act confident. You think you can do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, I'm doing it right now, aren't I? All right. Let's go in there.
Okay, let's go.
So you don't want them to know you're afraid?
No. It's much the same way that they behave with one another. We have to act the same way. We have to pretend we're not sick and pretend we're not tired and pretend we're not weaker than they are. And that is, gosh darn, that's pretend.
Yeah, that is pretend.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Feeling good.
Now, before we go in here, I just want to double check. Are you sure that you're feeling okay?
All I have to do is pretend I'm okay.
Just pretend.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Hi, guys. We're
going
to join Mark Bethel in here. He's another researcher out here at the Wildlife Science Center who helps.
Hi, Brett. Come on over here, buddy.
Come here, buddy.
Now, he walks up to you. Absolutely. Just greet him like you might greet anybody else.
Uh-huh.
He's telling us with his body language that he's not challenging us. His tail is low, his ears are low, and he's feeling a little bit submissive, but that's the way we like him.
We like him that
way.
That's
right.
Okay, hi, Brett. Good to see you. Now, you come in here for specific reasons, don't you?
Yes, we do.
You do work on these wolves.
Yes. When we hand raise an animal like this, it's for research and for study, but the benefits are that we can do things like care for them medically without having to tranquilize them all the time. Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't.
So you can sort of sneak up on them because you're friendly.
That's right. But today, for example, Brett is in need of one of his monthly injections to prevent heartworm or prevent other diseases. And so we're going to be able to do that as just part of our routine handling.
Okay. Well,
so
go ahead.
I'm just going to step over
and
around you.
Yeah, you.
And hi, sweetheart. How are you? And I'm going to operate. I'm going to distract the business end of things. And if you see, it really is the business end of things. While Mark sticks the needle in the back end.
Okay.
And you can see that we immerse this right inside of all kinds of pleasant but dominant kinds of behaviors. And
so
he doesn't even flinch.
He gets used to it, and it just becomes part of the routine, and
that's
it's not
right.
singled out as something that he has to worry
that's
about.
That's right. It's just another thing a dominant parent does.
Okay, we're going to take a short break now. We're going to show you some pictures of some wolves and ask you some questions. We'll be right back at another location. Moved a little bit, and we've got something very exciting to show you in just a second, because you had something wonderful happen here a little while
yes,
ago.
Yes, indeed.
Tell us about that. You had some puppies.
We had some puppies born.
Well, you didn't have some puppies. Who had the puppies?
Actually, Rebecca, one of the animals in the fight, once she got her own pack, she had puppies.
So she's an alpha now in another pack.
That's right.
How many puppies did you have?
She had five puppies, and Heather had five puppies, so we had 10. So.
Oh, my gosh. That's a lot of puppies to take care
of. Yes, indeed.
Now, we asked a question a couple of minutes ago on the tape, and that is, when do the puppies start that fight for dominance?
They begin that fight for dominance as soon as they can walk. So what you see sometimes is a little teeny puppy that looks like it's stumbling, doesn't have any teeth, but is already doing that same body language, biting muzzles, tails up, They start from the word go.
They really do, even before they can see.
Yes, it's very important.
It's the most important part.
That's right.
Okay, we have a videotape that was shot when the puppies were how old?
22 days.
22 days, yeah. Oh gosh.
They were cute.
Let's see the videotape.
Okay. Here we go. In this tape, I am bonding with them. They not only have food needs at this age, but they also have bonding needs because wolves have such strong family groups that being close to them and being family with them is just as important as caring for them with food. And that's what I get to do. That's the fun part of being a scientist, believe me.
Oh, I guess.
That's an awful lot of fun.
That's a deer leg.
Yeah, speaking of food, they are carnivores or meat eaters, and this is their first encounter with meat. We don't need to teach them to eat this. Deer is what they naturally encounter in the wild.
Their little noses are working.
That's right. They can barely see, but they can smell that meat. And although their teeth aren't all that large, they're still willing to give it a try. Their first day at it.
First time.
Yep, that's right. Isn't that a great
thing? Are you teaching them?
No, I'm not. That is also very natural with wolves. And we howl with them so that when they're adults, we can use that howl to call them.
So they recognize your voices if you start early enough.
That's right.
Yes.
Boy, that is a perk, isn't it?
It is. Tough life.
All right, we're going to go inside the pen with the puppies, and they're how old now?
They are now 5 months.
And why do, we got dogs here now. Why do you bring the dogs in?
The dogs speak that language better than I do. They have all the equipment to speak the same language that wolves do. Although they've been separated by something we call domestication, these guys still understand how to speak dog or wolf. So I'm going to let them off and go
greet
their puppies.
So does this make the puppies more comfortable?
It does indeed. These puppies, These puppies know the dogs, and you can see them greet the dogs by running up, licking their faces. The dogs speak the same language. Joshua raises his tail over the puppies, and the puppies feel automatically like, oh, okay, here's a parent. And that's the function of these dogs in this case.
Now, do you start handling these puppies as soon as they're born?
No, we don't.
To start
we
that
leave
bond?
Them. No, we leave them with mom for the first 10 days.
Why is that?
They need her nutrition, but in addition to that, when we're studying wolves, we want to be sure that we have wolves that are healthy. And oftentimes things that will kill a puppy will kill them in the first 10 days, and we let mom take care of that.
You just let them die if they're
going
to
right.
die.
That's right.
What about their families? How do they organize the families in relationship to the puppies?
Well, that's something else that's very unique with a wolf. These animals actually are excellent parents, and that's unusual. Mom, dad, aunts, and uncles, and everyone takes care of the pups, even though only that alpha male and alpha female breed.
Now, what is the dog doing?
Joshua is dominating those puppies. He's biting their muzzles just the same way an adult wolf would, and he's telling that puppy to stop, and that puppy is saying, okay, whatever you say, I'll stop.
You're the boss.
You're the boss. And you see that tail that dog is having high up there? The funny thing is that will change in the next year and a half, and the dogs won't be able to come in anymore.
Why?
Because dogs and wolves are not naturally friends like this. Wolves eat dogs in the wild.
They do?
And the light bulb will go on for these puppies, and they'll say, hey, you're just a dog.
And you're dinner.
That's right.
Wow. Now, you said all the members of the pack care for all the puppies?
Yes. It's very unusual, and it's a very collaborative effort. The parents will bring food home, but so will all the other members of the family.
What about feeding them? We had a question coming in from Rose Tree Elementary, and they asked, do wolves feed their young by throwing up in their mouths?
Well, they've got the right idea. They don't throw up into their mouths, but wolves oftentimes have to travel great distances with food, and it's easier to carry in their stomach, and then the actual term is regurgitation. It's not the same as throwing up because they're not sick, so it's really an amazing thing to see.
Yeah,
I'm just glad I'm not really a wolf.
Can we get closer to one of the pups?
Yeah, let me see if I can get one. Hi, guys. Hi, honeys. Shamey. Hi, Bunny. How are you? Well, look, I have a volunteer.
Is it all right if I come closer?
Yep. I'm going to carry him up here.
All right. Now, who is
this? This is Captain.
Captain. Hi, baby.
Captain's a big boy, Peggy.
Now, this is still a puppy, but how big is
this
puppy?
This is probably about 75, 80 pounds worth of puppy here.
Which is most of your weight, it looks like. And when does this puppy become full grown and start hunting?
Well, he'll join the family for the first time if you were in the wild at around 6 months. So not even quite. So that first 6 months of life, they have to put on as much bulk as they can. So they get about 2/3 their adult size by the time they're 6 months old. Now, they're not much help against a 1,000-pound moose if they're just little guys.
Yeah, so they don't even go out. They stay back.
No, they stay home. They stay home.
All right. Well, let's go. You can go ahead and put Captain down before you hurt your back there.
Yeah,
and we're
going
to take some more questions from some kids out there. Who do we have up first? We have Tony. Tony, are you out there with a question?
Yeah.
Okay, what is it? Go ahead and ask.
Why would a wolf become a lone wolf and be all by itself?
Why would a wolf become a lone wolf and go off by itself?
Very good question. Lone wolves actually are most often wolves that have either grown up and decided it's time for me to go out and start my own pack, which is what they'll do. They'll get to be adults and go, gosh, mom and dad are never going to let me breed. I'm going to go find my own mate. So that's one time that they become a lone wolf. Another lone wolf is if they get kicked out of the pack. So that's a lone
wolf. Why would they get kicked out?
They challenge dominance and lose. For example, Rebecca was kicked out of the pack, and she just had a place to go with food.
Oh.
Or if Raisa had lost and not died in the wild, she may have died. She may have become a lone wolf. So they would be booted out of the pack.
But that's
out.
A very vulnerable place
it
to be.
Indeed,
isn't it
is indeed, because those animals that they hunt are much bigger than themselves.
All right,
deer
well,
and
speaking
moose.
Of hunting, let's see what wolves eat now. We're going to have Mark come in and feed these puppies. Now, the puppies eat at this stage eat the same food that the adults do.
Yes, they do. Yes,
okay.
they do.
And what do you use to feed the. Oh, here we come. What do you use to feed the. Puppies.
We use roadkill deer. We live near the Twin Cities area in Minnesota, and there are lots and lots and lots. As a matter of fact, 9,000 white-tailed deer hit by cars every year
9,
in the state.
000.
That's right.
Oh,
just in the Twin
excited.
Cities. Yes, they are.
How much will the puppies eat, and how often do they eat?
Well, the puppies at this stage, these guys are just like teenagers. They're eating much more than they would if they were older. They can put away. It won't take them long to eat this whole deer at all. And you can see. Manners is really not an issue either.
Manners doesn't count.
Nope, not a bit.
Now, these are predators. What exactly is a predator?
Well, a predator is any time that you feed on a living thing for food. So technically, even a deer is a predator. But in this case, we're talking about animals that kill other animals to survive.
Do they ever kill more than they need?
Any time that an animal needs to hunt, if it's hard work and they had a chance to kill extra, they would. But nature oftentimes doesn't give wolves a chance. As a matter of fact, they're only successful about 5 to 6 times out of 100 that they try to catch something.
Wow.
So.
Now, we often have the idea that wolves are really vicious. And do they ever kill because they're mean?
No, not at all. It's been so long since we have had to hunt to survive that we've forgotten that hunting for food is just a process of nature. It's just a surviving thing. There's no maliciousness or viciousness involved.
Now, earlier we shot a tape of some adults feeding on a deer also, so we're going to run that videotape now. Do the adults feed a little differently than the puppies?
Yes, they do. What you're seeing here is opportunistic mayhem. Those puppies are just going to eat, but the adults eat based on rank. Those high-ranking wolves eat first, and the low-ranking wolves oftentimes won't even approach that deer carcass. So they
just wait.
Hang back. That's right.
Do the alphas ever leave them anything to eat?
Oh, sure, if they get full. There's no generosity here.
So they're very much in charge.
Yep.
So the feeding behavior is still in agreement with all of the other social structures.
Yes, and feeding, absolutely. Food is the life thread for a wolf pack.
Okay, well, let's come back to these puppies and look, because there's some hanging back. Now, why would they hang back when there's food?
Well, most of the time what they're hanging back from is just getting chewed out by Joshua the dog. Right there you have a high-ranking animal instantly, and he changes the dynamics. So they're coming up closer and closer because their own rank system is still not set. So they're going to compete a little more energetically.
Okay. Well, I think we're going to take another quick break here. We're going to show you some more pictures of wolves. And we'll be back in just, we're going to take one question before we go. Do we have a question from the kids out here? Do we have a phone question? Okay, we have a phone question coming in. It's Taylor. Taylor, are you out there?
Yes.
Taylor, what's your question today?
How long can a lone wolf survive in alone?
How long can a lone wolf survive?
Taylor, you guys are asking some hard questions today.
That
question,
work, huh?
That's right. That's a tough question. Oftentimes, lone wolves will survive for months. Some lone wolves have even been known to survive for years, but it's a very unusual thing that lone wolves would live by themselves. Most often, they wouldn't choose to. They would look for another animal to hook up with. So it's really an in-transition state to be a lone wolf. You're in between packs.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to take a quick break, and maybe you can talk amongst yourselves about what you think about this feeding. And we're going to ask you a couple more questions, and we'll be right back. Welcome back. We have moved to another part of the compound, and we're going to do something that you do a lot in terms of your research on these wolves. You're going to immobilize a wolf.
That's right.
Now, tell me why that is important.
Okay.
For you to practice that.
When we say immobilize, what we mean is we administer enough of an anesthetic or a tranquilizer to render that wolf unconscious for a short amount of time. And that sounds easy, but it isn't. It's very important to have the right drug for the right animal and the right amount.
Now, how do you figure, let's talk about amount, because that seems like it's real important.
That's right.
Tell me how you figure the amount.
Well, it took many, many years of research and study to find out what dose worked for what animal.
And you do that research here?
Yes, we've done that for many years here so that we can safely go into field situations and administer these drugs and know that we're not going to harm an animal.
Okay, so give me the problem.
Okay.
How do you figure that out?
Okay, well, I'm going to work on an animal today that's about 100 pounds, Rebecca, and
the one in the fight.
Yes, the one in the fight. And you'll see that Rebecca's in one piece and looking good. Actually, she's a little more than one piece. She's a big girl. She's getting two drugs. One is called ketamine, and she will get 10 milligrams per kilogram of ketamine. And she will get a second drug, is xylazine, and she'll get 1 milligram per kilogram of xylazine. Now, both of these drugs come in a concentration of 100 milligrams per milliliter. Now, my question is, how many milliliters do I give Rebecca?
Did y'all follow that? I hope you did. Okay, why don't we go into the cage, give you a couple of seconds to see if you can start working on that problem. And Mark Beckel is going to join us again, and he's going to bring some equipment in. Can we go on in there?
You betcha. Let's grab our kit.
And we're going to have a student working on here, working on that same problem, to see if she comes up with the same answer you do. Now, again, that same behavior, we have to act like we're not afraid, right?
That's right.
Okay.
Actually, Rebecca's more afraid in here.
Is she?
Yep.
Okay. Now, what will you do to immobilize this animal?
Rebecca is an animal that was socialized or hand-raised, so we're going to be able to walk right up to her and give her that anesthetic without much problem at all.
Okay, well, you've prepared a shot.
Yes.
And I want to go back out to our student and see if we can find out if our student Carrie has come up with that answer. Okay, Carrie, tell us how you got this. Now, you're going to have to speak real loud, so just tell me what you went through to get that answer.
Well, first of all, you have to convert kilograms to pounds and then milligrams to milliliters.
Wow,
so,
okay.
You have a 100-pound wolf, and you have to convert that to kilograms. So you divide by 2.2, and you get 45.45 kilograms, or 46 rounded up. And then you take milligrams of ketamine, and it's the ratio is 10 milligrams per kilogram. So we have to figure out how many milligrams for 46 kilograms. So it's 10 times 46 kilograms over kilograms, which those cancel out to get 460 milligrams.
Okay.
And you do the same with the xylazine. The ratio is 1 milligram per kilogram. And so you have to figure out how many milligrams for 46 kilograms. And so the equation would be 1 times 46 kilograms per kilograms, and the kilogram cancels out to get 46 milligrams.
Very good.
And then you have to figure out how many milliliters, because that's how they give them the drug. And so the ratio would be 100 milligrams per milliliter. So 460 milligrams per 100 milligrams cancels out the milligrams to get 4.6 milliliters.
Of ketamine.
Yes. Okay. And then the xylazine, it's the same ratio, and then you get 46 milligrams over 100 milligrams, and the milligrams cancel out to get 0.46 milliliters.
Okay, well, I hope that's right. Can you hang on to that
sure.
for me? And we're going to go back in and see if you got the right answer. How did they do?
She did very well, and it took her a lot less time than it would have taken me, so.
Okay, well, you might want to offer her a job. All right, I'm going to stand back here and let you go ahead and prepare the animal and anesthetize the animal.
Okay.
And then we'll talk again.
Great. Sounds good. One of the things I'm going to do as we go back here is talk, because Rebecca lives with me. She's not used to quiet people.
Baby.
So, as we approach Rebecca, hi, Rebecca. We're going to greet her. If you notice when I greet her, my voice is raised in pitch. That's because when wolves greet one another, they will oftentimes whine, and you just might hear that if you listen.
Hi, sweetheart.
If I lowered my voice, it would sound more like a growl, so that would sound like I was being threatening. Hi there, darling.
You're okay.
Hi,
you're
honey.
Okay.
Hi. Oh. Rebecca's going to lie here very quietly.
This is
what
no
a good
big
girl.
Deal.
Good girl.
Good
the first
girl.
Thing that we're going to do is pet Rebecca and say
there
hi.
There you go.
How are you? Good girl.
There
good
you go.
Girl. Good girl. So she's pretty comfortable now. And again, I'm going to sit on the business end of things while Mark gives her the injection. And it's going to sting just a little bit. Anybody who's ever gotten a shot knows that. But that's about all. Won't do much more than that. Hi, Galileo.
There you go.
No problem. Now what we'll do is back and let Rebecca go to sleep.
There you go, sweetheart.
Hi, buddy. Hi, sweetie. So it looks pretty easy, huh, Peggy?
Yeah, sure. It looked real easy to me. Of course, I wasn't over there. Now, how long will that take to take effect?
Oh, it takes about 5 to 10 minutes maybe for the animal to be completely unconscious or to a point that's safe enough to work with.
And that's safe for you and the wolf.
That's right. That's
okay.
Right.
So while we're waiting for the anesthetic to take effect, we've got a couple other things we want to talk about. First of all, these are also hand-raised wolves.
Yes.
So these are socialized.
Yes.
Is the procedure different when you anesthetize a wild animal?
Very different. Very different.
What do you do with that? You've got a bunch of stuff.
Yeah,
here.
We've got some tools here that will help us explain it. First of all, a wild wolf is going to be so terrified of us that to allow us to corner them just wouldn't happen. They'll even hurt themselves to get away. So this is really mostly a scary device. We don't really hit them with it, but if we need to be able to land them to hold them down long enough to give a shot, this will help. And then once we get an animal cornered, this device called the pin stick, it's forked like this and it's got all kinds of padding, and you can see the teeth marks
in
here.
Oh yeah, it's been bit.
This one will help us pin their necks in a way that they dominate one another. So we do something that makes sense to them when we want them to stop moving.
So it's not as confusing as it might seem.
Nope, it makes sense to them, and it's in some ways probably comforting. The next thing that we do is walk in with a pole syringe. It's just a syringe on a pole, and this saves my hand from a good sound nip and makes them feel more comfortable than if I reached up with a hand, because they think that we're very dangerous.
Wolves think we're
dangerous. Oh, yes.
All right, so we have a tape of you anesthetizing one of the wild animals here. That's Draven, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, let's take a look at that videotape, and I want you to tell me what's happening as we watch that tape.
Okay. Well, you can see that we've acted as a human shield, and we've got Draven cornered in the back. You can just see the net there. And obviously, he's not lunging at anybody. He looks like he's trying to get as far away from humans as possible. And once we have him in a corner, Mark will approach here with the forked stick, and there's the tooth mark that you're looking at.
Oh, yeah.
But when he bites and feels nervous enough, we can quietly, calmly pin him in the corner while I walk in with the pole syringe and administer the anesthetic. Now, once we finish that, you would think that he would lunge at somebody if the stick's taken away. But no, indeed, what you see instead is that he runs away.
So he doesn't really want to be around you.
No, he doesn't want to be around me at all. He is trying to stay away.
Now, it looks like it hurts him. Is it hurting him?
No, one of the things that we can tell you about anesthesia is that number one, they don't feel any pain, and number two, they don't know where they are. And the reason he looks like he's struggling is because any wild animal is going to try to keep their feet underneath them, whereas if I felt that much like lying down, I'd do it.
Yeah, I would too. So he's down now.
Yes, he is. It'll take a few more minutes before he's safe to handle, and once he is safe to handle, we always carry them up into a place where if we needed to respond to an emergency, we could do so quickly and safely.
So it's really to keep the wolf safe.
That's right. Once he's down, we do a complete physical exam on him. One of the things we look at, of course, is their feet. It's very easy for them to get injured. And look at the size of that big snowshoe that they've got as feet. It's an impressive thing. And their teeth, they need these to survive, and they're his weapons.
They are.
Business end of things. Their jaw pressure is 1,500 pounds per square inch. That's a lot of pressure.
That's a lot.
Yep. Then we take blood samples, not only to monitor their health, but also because we provide blood samples for research projects all over the place, not only when we are doing them, but other scientists as well that may not have access to wolves that need to conduct research. And then, just like when you go to the doctor, one of the ways to find out their health and monitor their health is to take a weight. That beautiful fur coat kind of masks their weight, and oops, looks like Draven is in no trouble there. 100 pounds,
he's a big boy.
Plenty of pounds. The last thing that you see Mark doing there is administering the reversal agent, which takes away one of the operating drugs. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that Draven has all of his faculties about him right away. So what we do is we choose to move him safely and carefully into a place where he can recover from the remaining effects of the drugs without hurting himself or getting into any trouble.
So the other animals might take advantage of him being down.
That's right, and that's something else to consider when you're working on wild wolves in the field, that drugging doses become so important if you're working on a wolf that's living in the middle of northern Minnesota.
So he's going to be okay, and he just wakes up slowly.
Absolutely. It actually takes him very little time. 20 minutes or so, he'll be fine.
Wow. Give me a specific example of how the research that you've done here translates into the wild. Like, you worked on, you did some of the background research on the wolves that were released in Yellowstone.
That's right.
How did that research that you did apply?
Well, one of the functions of this facility has been to test these anesthetics, and maybe it doesn't sound terribly important until you look at a situation like Yellowstone, where you're capturing a wolf that doesn't want to be caught. So we start in a safe, controlled setting with a wolf like Rebecca that's non-stressed, she's healthy, we know everything that's going on with her. We test the effects of an anesthetic safely here, and then we move up to a wolf like Draven, who's wild and who's a little more stressed, because physically Rebecca and Draven are two different animals due to that stress.
Oh, so when you go out into the wild, you have to know the dosages for a stressed animal.
That's right. And for an animal that may be suffering from things like parasites, which Rebecca and Draven are not suffering from, or other physical problems that we can't see by looking from a helicopter.
Oh, all right. Now, let's go back to that Yellowstone, because you had the scientists who were involved in that here, and
yes,
they did
we
some
did.
Research before that release.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Not only do we test anesthetics, but we also allow people an opportunity to work with them on real live animals. So they're not just reading about the effects. They can actually experience what it's like to administer the drugs and watch that animal go down and work with it.
Okay. Now, we have a videotape of that release in Yellowstone, and they were captured where, the wolves?
They were in Alberta, Canada.
All right. Well, let's take a look at that videotape.
There it
we
is.
Can see right here. What's going
yes,
on?
This is, well, a wolf is being pursued by a helicopter. And talk about a stressed animal. That animal's plenty stressed. So he will get darted, which is a very difficult procedure, but look, they knew the exact right drug dosage to use in order to get him to lose consciousness but not be in too much trouble. So they will take him. They gathered, their permit was for 30 different wolves. They collected 30 different wolves and brought them back to a main holding area. And they had to all be transported by helicopter, so this was an enormous procedure, both expensive and very dangerous and difficult. Here you see them getting a medical exam where all their blood samples were taken. They were all fitted with radio collars, and then they were carried out and placed into transport boxes, because they were not just going to be dropped off the road. They were actually going to be taken way, way far, far away. These traveling cases are animal safe. You can see a variety of different people, and the procedure to get there is just amazing. From rental trucks to mules and everything else, it was really, really a remote area. The areas that they were released into were areas that were studied, not only so that they'd be big enough and remote enough, but also did they have enough food. There's no point in bringing a wolf down and letting it go someplace where it can't find enough to eat.
So the wolves will be comfortable where they're released.
That's right. That's right, as long as people leave them alone. The neat thing about this particular effort, you can see you have wildlife biologists here, you have veterinarians, you have private folks, people who own the mules, the director of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service is in this film clip, all kinds of folks. This was a neat collaborative effort between public and private, all kinds of different folks working together.
A lot of people rooting for the wolf.
That's right.
They took them way out there.
Way out there. Way out there. This was an enormous expense and a very exciting moment for those people who waited for many years. And it was fun to have some of these folks here at the center and give them an opportunity to do this in a controlled setting before they were out in the middle of nowhere. And you can see once those wolves are released, they know exactly what to do.
They are out of there.
They are out of there. They didn't run at any people, so Little Red Riding Hood gets one more blow against it.
They just wanted to go.
They just wanted to go. They wanted to get far, far away, and in front of all kinds of very, very fortunate observers.
Wouldn't you love to be there?
Yes. So, finally, the wolf, the last remaining thing, is back in the Rockies.
Back in the ecosystem.
Yep.
Great. All right, I'm going to introduce another scientist that you work with. Ani, come on in here. This is Ani Byers. She's another wolf research scientist. Is Rebecca ready?
I'm going to go check on Rebecca.
Okay, why don't you go ahead bring her up here. Ani, you also do research on wolves. What kind of research are you doing?
My field of research is primarily reproduction. So the research that I've been working on involves the controlling of reproduction or contraception of wolves.
Okay. We've got Rebecca. Come on in. We've got some kids who want to come in here and see this exam. So hurry on in here, kids. We have to do this fairly quickly. So why don't you come on in, get right behind them so that you can see what they're doing, and just sort of walk us through what you would normally do on an exam.
Well, the first thing that we have to do when we get an animal in here like this is she's been given a tranquilizer. So we examine her. And find out, is she breathing? Does she look comfortable? Is she healthy? And just judging from the size of her, she looks very healthy. We check to see what her eyes look like. And you can see that they are still look like they're open, but she's unconscious. It's one of the drugs that we use, is a very, very safe drug to use, so she still will have her eyes looking. And what Ani is doing is checking for any kind of injuries, because look at that thick fur. You could never, ever, ever tell whether there's any injuries with that thick fur. While she's doing that and examining the animal, I'm going to take a blood sample, not only to monitor Rebecca's health, and by the way, this is Rebecca. Doesn't she look great after that fight?
She sure does.
We're going to take blood samples for scientists, too.
The really wonderful thing about the Wildlife Science Center is that these animals, because they're not stressed, provide access to normal blood serum.
Sort of baseline.
Baseline that you can't get in most places. The stress hormones change the levels of all other hormones in the blood, so it's really an incredible opportunity for researchers all over the world.
So you send the wolf blood all over the world.
Right, and people know that they can contact the Wildlife Science Center because they store the blood serum. So they can get those normal values.
So you're taking blood now. What else will you do?
We will also administer an antibiotic which will keep her from getting any infections after all of this handling. And she doesn't look like she's going to have any problems at all. This is a big girl. But this antibiotic right here is just like what you get at the doctor. If you had any kind of cut or injury, they'd give you this to prevent the same thing, to make sure you didn't get sick. So I'm going to give this in the muscle. She isn't going to feel a darn thing because she doesn't feel anything right now. And that's just a safe thing. Another thing that we're going to do here is administer a heartworm preventative, just like we did with Brett in North Peck. And that goes right under the skin. Their skin is a lot looser than ours, so we don't have to worry about going underneath any new muscle. Okay?
So it's really like when you kids go to the doctor, you get vaccinations, you get blood samples, you get weighed.
That's right. That's right. All kinds of different things. You folks here, see, look at how big, huge her feet are compared to your hands. Can I have a volunteer's hands here? Who have I got? Look at all those hands. Look at the hands. That's incredible. How about your hands? Look at that. Her feet are larger than her hands. That's because she needs to stay on top of the snow when she's traveling great distances.
Okay, the last thing you would do would then be
The last thing that I would do is administer a reversal agent, and that will take away the effects of one of those drugs and make certain that Becca can recover safely.
Okay, since she's going to wake up now, I think it's time for you kids to take a hike. You might want to get out of the way because you need to move this wolf to a holding pen so she can wake up safely.
That's right.
And how long will it take to wake up?
Well, the effects of this first drug will be reversed in just a few minutes. The second drug may take her a little while longer to come out of, but that's why we put her in a place where she's very safe.
Okay, well, while you're doing that, we're going to go out, and I'm going to go out myself as she wakes up, and we're going to talk to somebody else. And wolves are also very important to this person. We're going to talk to a member of the Ojibwe tribe. And you are, where are you?
Right here behind
you. There you are, sorry. Ran away from you. Kathleen Kalina, you're a member of the Ojibwe tribe and you're a member of the Bear Clan. Now tell me about clans. How are the clans organized?
Since time immemorial, the indigenous peoples of this country have a social system, much like you've seen with the wolves, to keep themselves organized and to keep the checks and balances. And each clan is designated in, with the spirit of a particular animal.
And then how does that affect the people to be part of that spirit?
Well, the spirit of the animal takes on a certain responsibility. So
like you're in the member of the bear clan. What does that mean to you?
Well, the bear is going out into the woods, digging roots, eating berries, and so forth. It's very close to nature. So a person in the bear clan would be very much responsible for the medicines. They're controlling the cubs and the family, so we would protect children. Also, the village. And so if we take that a step further in modern-day society, we would be very much interested in environmental protection, protecting the village from outside things that might want to contaminate it. So we would take it that step further.
Now, you're not only a member of the Ojibwe tribe and the Bear Clan, you're also a PhD student in fisheries.
Yes.
Now, fish have become very important to you in the Bear Clan. How does that work?
Well, the bear really likes fish, and so there's a natural extension to other animals that relate to your particular clan. And so these animals, such as the fish for food, is something that I'm interested in my work. And so this is why I went into fisheries.
Now, you have sort of a communication with these animals, but the animals don't really talk, so, or do they?
Well, there's other kinds of messages. There's nonverbal messages and intuitive messages. We believe any time you have an encounter with a wild animal that seems abnormal but seems coming to you in a way that is unusual for its normal path of endeavor, then that may be the spirit of that animal is communicating something to you, sending you some sort of message. And we would take that as a very important sign.
Okay. We're going to take a couple of questions, and I'm hoping Peggy Callahan can come over here and help me answer them. There you are, Peggy. But you stay around, too, in case we have some for you. We have Tommy from Virginia. Tommy, are you out there?
Hi.
Hi, Tommy. What's your question?
My name is Tommy, and I'm from Blacksburg. And I go to Gilbert Lincus Elementary. My question is, if a wolf leaves his pack, if he forms a new pack, is he automatically the alpha wolf?
That's a good question.
That is a good question.
If you go out and become a lone wolf and start your own, do you automatically rise to the top?
Well, actually, if you start your own, you get to start from the beginning, and what happens is that lone wolf, if it's a male, and I'm suggesting that it is, a male or a female hooks up with the opposite gender, and those two are automatically the alpha because the rest of the pack is made up of several generations of their pups.
Okay.
And that's usually what we see in puppies, in packs.
So they do. They
absolutely
do. Okay. Well, I would think so.
Yeah.
Okay. We have a question from Andy, who's in Waconia. Andy, what's your question?
I was wondering if I could name one of your wolves George.
George. Now, what would be the reason for that?
Because I like that name.
Okay. George?
Well, you know, I have to tell you, I'm particular about how my animals are named. If you can come to me with a characteristic description that fits one of my animals' personalities, and it's George, which I don't think it will be, then we'll work together.
Because you're not naming your animals as pets again.
No.
You're naming them because it's
because of their rank. It helps me to remember what role they play in the pack.
Okay, great. We're going to take a question that came in on a fax right now. And Star and Tim in Indiana want to know, what's the current wolf population in North America and worldwide?
Well, I'm going to start locally. Minnesota, we have a population of around 1,700 wolves. In the United States, they occupy less than 1% of their former range.
Less than
1% of their former range, yes. Wolves, there are still wolves in Canada because it's pretty remote and tough to get up there and kill them off. We still have wolves in Alaska, but we have very few in the southern the United States below Canada.
Wow.
So
very much reduced.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Joanne is in Montana. Joanne, are you out there with a question?
Uh-huh.
Ask it.
If a wolf dies and the food is scarce, will the pack eat the wolf?
Oh. Do they ever cannibalize their own?
Most often they don't. And there are probably some good reasons to restrain yourself from doing that. You get the same diseases as the one that died, so tend to avoid doing something like that. Now, that's not to say if you're starving to death, I don't think that there's any animal that wouldn't cannibalize. But, again, it's a tough thing to remember. There's nothing mean or nasty about this kind of thing.
Okay. Let's quickly check on Rebecca and see how she's doing. Is she starting to wake up now?
She's starting to wake up. It'll be a gradual process for Rebecca, but she looks like she's starting to think about things again. She's far, far out of the woods now.
And again, it doesn't really hurt them, does it?
No, it doesn't. And she won't remember anything that happened this afternoon either.
Okay. We're going to take another question here. That's a fax. We came in on fax. Does the female wolf tend to be kinder and more at ease than a male? After seeing that fight, my guess would be no, but
nope.
You go ahead.
Well, it's an interesting question. What I have found is that they are equal in terms of how aggressive or how nasty or how kind and gentle they can be. And the females will fight with females, the males will fight with males, and they share responsibility. Now, the only exception is when that female has puppies. Everybody in the pack jumps when she says jump.
Oh, she does?
Yep.
Everybody?
Yep.
What about seasonally? Does it change during breeding season and then pupping season?
Yes, it's so interesting. All of the females are very, very tense in the wintertime, and oftentimes those low-ranking females don't even have enough food or nutrition to be breeding females anyway. But once the pups are on the ground, all of the aggression and tension from the breeding season is gone,
okay.
And you have a very comfortable situation.
Good. We have a great question coming in from Maria in Denver. She wants to know, will the wolves that were sent to Yellowstone form a new pack?
Actually, that's a wonderful question. They're choosing that on themselves. Actually, what did was humans kind of paired them up. A few arranged marriages were made. Some worked and some didn't. And those animals are going out on their own and establishing territory. So there are actually several new packs that have set up, not just one. And some of those animals that were brought into Yellowstone have had puppies. So they've started families right away.
That's great.
Yes.
Do we have time for one more question? We've got one here. No, we don't have time for any more questions. We have time for this, though.
That's another characteristic
of wolves that we hear a lot about, but we haven't covered today, and that's the howling.
Yes.
So let's go over here and talk with these kids. And can you teach them how to howl? We heard you earlier.
Absolutely. My Friday nights. Okay, listen. One of the things that wolves have that we don't is that long, long hallway for the noise to come out. So we're going to have to make that with our hands. It's not cupping over your mouth, but making a hallway for the sound to travel down, and it really carries that way. So I'm going to do it first, you guys watch, and then I want to hear you guys howl, okay? So it starts like this. Easy? Okay, one, two, three, go. Some good wolves in here, guys.
That's great. Okay, let's take one more quick check on Rebecca to see how she's doing. How does she look to you?
Rebecca looks good. She's waking up nicely. In about a half an hour, Rebecca will be ready to go back to her boys.
Okay, very good. All right, we're going to howl our way out of here. Go ahead, kids. Let me hear you howl.
Okay.
Okay, we're going to show you one more piece of equipment. These are things that we don't see very often, but let's take a look at these. These look nasty. What is this?
This is the research trap that's used to catch wolves. I think one of the things that people forget is that when you're catching something that doesn't want to be caught, sometimes it does get hurt. And there are animals that are injured in this trap. These teeth actually hold the foot still and do less damage than if the edges were perfectly straight. This is a research trap. Remember that. So that there's always two decisions, two sides of every decision, a good side or the benefits, and a cost side or the damage that could be done.
Why is it safer for the wolf to have those teeth?
The teeth will actually hold that foot still. We saw how large those front toes were. If there aren't the teeth, the foot can move back and forth in the metal and rub down to bone. So actually, over many years, scientists have discovered this is less damaging. Now, it's not perfect, but until someone comes up with something, and I'll look at all the smart scientists we have budding here, we are stuck with this.
Okay, great. Now, there's a hook on the bottom.
That's right.
That looks dangerous.
This hook actually is what gets caught around a tree. And I had an encounter on Isle Royal when I was out there of a hook that didn't get caught around the tree. So I ended up grabbing onto the end of it. And I was lying on my stomach face to face with a wolf caught by his toes. And he didn't even wrinkle his lips at me.
He didn't.
So this trap taught me an awful lot about Little Red Riding Hood.
I guess so. All right, kids, we've run out of time. Go ahead and howl out of here. We hope you've enjoyed the World of Wolves from the Wildlife Science Center in Forest Lake, Minnesota. Very special thank you to Bell Live, the Wildlife Science Center, and our biologist, Peggy Callahan. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. I won't try that.